Levites whom David had distributed in the house of the Lord to offer the burnt offerings of the Lord, as it is written in the law of Moses, with rejoicing and with singing, as it was ordained by David. And he set the porters at the gates of the house of the Lord, that none which was unclean in anything should enter in. And he took the captains of hundreds, and the nobles, and the governors of the people, and all the people of the land, and brought down the king from the house of the Lord. And they came through the high gate into the king's house, and set the king upon the throne of the kingdom. And all the people of the land rejoiced, and the city was quiet after that they had slain Athaliah with the sword. Ladies and gentlemen, I have the high honor and the distinct privilege and the great pleasure and joy, and I mean that, to read the Word of God found in Isaiah chapter 45. Pardon me. Isaiah chapter 45. Thus saith the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have holden, to subdue nations before him, and I will loose the loins of kings, to open before him the two leaved gates, and the gates shall not be shut. I will go before thee and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of brass, and cut in sunder the bars of iron. And I will give thee the treasures of darkness, and hidden riches of secret places, that thou mayest know that I, the Lord, which call thee by thy name, am the God of Israel. For Jacob my servant's sake, and Israel my elect, I have even called thee by thy name. I have surenamed thee, though thou hast not known me. I am the Lord, and there is none else. There is no God beside me. I girded thee, though thou hast not known me, that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none beside me. I am the Lord, and there is none else. I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create evil. I, the Lord, do all these things. Drop down, ye heavens, from above, and let the skies pour down righteousness. Let the earth open, and let them bring forth salvation, and let righteousness spring up together. I, the Lord, have created it. Woe unto him that striveth with his maker. Let the potsherds strive with the potsherds of the earth. Shall the clay say to him that fashioneth it, what makest thou, or thy work? He Woe unto him that saith unto his father, What begettest thou? Or to the woman, What hast thou brought forth? Thus saith the Lord, the Holy One of Israel, and his Maker, Ask me of things to come concerning my sons and concerning the work of my hands, command ye me. I have made the earth and created man upon it. I even, my hands, have stretched out the heavens, and all their host have I commanded. I have raised him up in righteousness, and I will direct all his ways. He shall build my city, and he shall let go my captives. Not for price nor reward, saith the Lord of hosts. Thus saith the Lord, the labor of Egypt, and merchandise of Ethiopia, and of the Sabaeans, men of stature, shall come over unto thee, and they shall be thine. They shall come after thee in chains. They shall come over, and they shall fall down unto thee. They shall make supplication unto thee, saying, Surely God is in thee, and there is none else. There is no God. Verily, thou art a God that hidest thyself, O God of Israel, the Savior. They shall be ashamed and also confounded, all of them. They shall go to confusion together, that are makers of idols. But Israel shall be saved in the Lord with an everlasting salvation. Ye shall not be ashamed nor confounded, world without end. For thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God himself that formed the earth and made it. He hath established it. He hath created it. Not in vain. He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is none else. I have not spoken in secret, in a dark place of the earth. I said not unto the seed of Jacob, Seek ye me in vain. I, the Lord, speak righteousness. I declare things that are right. Assemble yourselves and come, draw near together, ye that are escaped of the nations. They have no knowledge, but set up the wood of their graven image, and pray unto a God that cannot save. Tell ye and bring them near, yea, let them take counsel together. Who hath declared this from ancient time? Who hath told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? And there is no God else beside me, a just God and a Savior. There is none beside me. Look unto me, and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth. For I am God, and there is none else. I have sworn by myself, the word is gone out of my mouth in righteousness. And shall not return, that unto me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear. Surely shall one say, In the Lord have I righteousness and strength. And even to him shall men come, and all that are increased, or rather all that are incensed against him, shall be ashamed. In the Lord shall all the seed of Israel be justified, and show glory. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I have the high honor and the distinct privilege and the Micah chapter 7. Micah chapter 7, woe is me, for I am as when they have gathered the summer fruits, as the grape gleanings of the vintage. There is no cluster to eat. My soul desired the first ripe fruit. The good man is perished out of the earth. And there is none upright among men. They all lie in wait for blood. They hunt every man his brother with a net, that they may do evil with both hands earnestly. The prince asketh, and the judge asketh for a reward, and the great man, he uttereth his mischievous desire, so they wrap it up. The best of them is as a briar, the most upright is sharper than a thorn hedge. The day of thy watchman and thy visitation cometh, now shall be their perplexity. Trust ye not in a friend, put ye not confidence in a guide. Keep the doors of thy mouth from her that lieth in thy bosom. For the son dishonoreth the father, the daughter riseth up against her mother, the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies are the men of his own house. Therefore, I will look unto the Lord, I will wait for the God of my salvation. My God will hear me. Rejoice not against me, O my enemy, when I fall. I shall arise, when I sit in darkness, the Lord shall be a light unto me. I will bear the indignation of the Lord, because I have sinned against him, until he plead my cause and execute judgment for me. He will bring me forth to the light, and I shall behold his righteousness. Then she that is mine enemy shall see it, and shame shall cover her, who said unto me, where is the Lord thy God? Mine eyes shall behold her, now shall she be trodden down as the mire of the streets. In the day that thy walls are to be built, in that day shall the decree be far removed. In that day also he shall come even to thee, from Assyria, and from the fortified cities, and from the fortress even to the river, and from sea to sea, and from mountain to mountain. Notwithstanding, the land shall be desolate, because of them that dwell therein, for the fruit of their doings. Feed thy people with thy word, the flock of thine herd. Feed thy people with thy rod, pardon me, the flock of thine heritage, which dwell solitarily in the wood. In the midst of Carmel, let them feed in Bashan and Gilead, as in the days of old, according to the days of thy coming out of the land of Egypt. Will I show unto him marvelous things? The nations shall see and be confounded, and all their might. They shall lay their hand upon their mouth, their ears shall be deaf. They shall lick the dust like a serpent. They shall move out of their holes like worms on the earth. They shall be afraid of the Lord our God, and shall fear because of thee. Who is a God like unto thee, that pardoneth iniquity, and passeth by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? He retaineth not his anger forever, because he delighteth in mercy. He will turn again, he will have compassion upon us. He will subdue our iniquities, and thou wilt cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. Thou wilt perform the truth to Jacob, and the mercy to Abraham, which thou hast sworn unto our fathers from the days of old. Shall we pray? Holy Father God, we praise you and we thank you for your holy word. And we thank you, Lord, for those truths and those memory verses that stood out as we read. Have your holy word to find a lodging place in our hearts. And Lord, help us to meditate on your holy word, to obey it, to share it with others, and to be an encouragement to others who are struggling on this difficult road. In Jesus Christ, I will pray for yourself. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, this is Daniel White, the third president of Gospel Light Society International, with the Scripture and the Sense podcast, episode number 665, where I simply read the Word of God and give the sense of it based on an authoritative commentary source such as the Bible Knowledge Commentary. commentary, and or the Matthew Henry commentary. This podcast is based upon Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 8, where it says, Ezra and the Levites read in the book in the law of God distinctly and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. The aim of this podcast, therefore, is that through the simple reading of the Word of God with prayer, it is indeed my prayer that in the giving of the sense and understanding of it, it is indeed my prayer that the church will be revived and that the world will be awakened and saved from the wrath to come and from the eternal burning hell. Today, dear friends, we're reading Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 2. Holy Father God, we thank you for your holy word. Grant us your grace and your strength and the power of your Holy Spirit, your unction and your anointing, to understand your holy word and to obey it and to live by it and to share it with others and to proclaim your gospel from it. In Jesus Christ's name we pray for your sake. Amen. O Lord, how long shall I cry, and thou wilt not hear, even cry out unto thee of violence, and thou wilt not save? Ladies and gentlemen, I just read in your hearing Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 2. Now, here is the sense of it. Here is the understanding of it. The Bible Knowledge Commentary, it says, the prophet's long-standing concern, which finally erupted into a volcanic complaint, was twofold. First, he wanted to know why God seemed so indifferent. Why doesn't God hear? Second, he wanted to know why God seemed so insensitive. Why doesn't God help? Habakkuk's words, how long show his agony over God's seeming delay in responding to the prophet's concerns. Many Christians today sense the same problem. They wonder why God seems silent when they pray. Like several psalmists, Habakkuk went to God to complain about his troubles and the troubles of his people. He described the injustice that was rampant around him. And then asked, how long and why? Later he used these same words again. This prophet sounded more like a singer than a seer. Part of Israel's worship involved making impassioned pleas to God for help in times of desperate trouble. Israel did not normally complain about its troubles in letters to the editor. They took their pleas directly to God in worship and in prayer and in song. Habakkuk's concern was not only that his cries went unheeded, but that the corruption continued unchecked. He cried out to God, violence, but God seemed to do nothing. The stark word violence sums up all the chaos Habakkuk witnessed around him. The word is sprinkled throughout the book like ink blots on a crumpled page in history. Holy Father God, we praise you and we thank you for this time together in your holy word. Lord, help us to apply your holy word and what we have learned to our own lives and to meditate on it and to change from it and to share it with others and to proclaim your holy gospel in these perilous times. In Jesus Christ's name, God, we pray and for our sake. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Daniel White, President of Gospel Light of Society International, with the White House Family Devotional Reading of Charles Haddon Spurgeon's fantastic devotional book titled Morning and Evening. This is the podcast, and this is episode number 275. Our scripture passage chosen by the Prince of Preachers today is 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, which reads, He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also so to walk even as he walked. Why should Christians imitate Christ? They should do it for their own sakes. If they desire to be in a healthy state of soul, if they would escape the sickness of sin and enjoy the vigor of growing in grace and by grace, let Jesus be their model for their own happiness, for their own happiness' sake. If they would drink wine on the lees, well refined, if they would enjoy holy and happy communion with Jesus, if they would be lifted up above the cares and troubles of this world, let them walk even as he walked. There is nothing which can so assist you to walk towards heaven with good speed as wearing the image of Jesus on your heart to rule all its emotions. It is when by the power of the Holy Spirit you are enabled to walk with Jesus in his very footsteps that you are most happy and most known to be the sons of God, yea, daughters of God. Peter, far off, is both unsafe and uneasy. Next, for religion's sake, strive to be like Jesus. Poor religion, thou hast been surely and sorely shot at by cruel foes. Thou hast not been wounded one half so dangerously by thy foes as by thy friends, who made those wounds in the fair hand of godliness. The professor who used the dagger of hypocrisy, the man who with pretenses enters the fold, being naught but a wolf in sheep's clothing, worries the flock more than the lion outside. There is no weapon half so deadly as a Judas kiss. Inconsistent professors injure the gospel more than the sneering critic or the infidel or the atheist. But especially for Christ's own sake, imitate his example. Christian, lovest thou thy Savior? Is his name precious to see, and rather to thee? Is his name precious to thee? Is his cause dear to thee? Is it? Wouldst thou see the kingdoms of the world become his? Is it thy desire that he should be glorified? Art thou longing that souls should be won to him? If so, imitate Jesus. Be an epistle of Christ, known and read of all men. Holy Father God, we praise you and we thank you for your holy word and for this powerful devotional. Lord, help us to take heed to it and go and do what we should do based upon what we have heard. In Jesus Christ's name, we do pray and for his sake. Amen. Now, dear friend, if you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, here is how you can be saved from hell when you die and saved to heaven and walk with the Lord morning and evening, if you will, until you go to that wonderful place called heaven after you die. And we're all going to die. And though it may sound rather morbid, we're all going to die. First, accept the fact that you are a sinner. And that you have broken God's law. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We all have sinned against God. I hope that you can agree with that. Second, accept the fact that there is a penalty for sin. The Bible states in Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death. We die because of our sin, our sinful nature, and the sins we choose to do. The body goes to the grave when we die. The soul goes to the eternal burning hell immediately when we die, if we do not trust Jesus Christ as Savior. Speaking of hell, thirdly, accept the fact, then, dear friend, that you are on the road to hell if you have never believed in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ said in Matthew 18:8, in one of his many sermons on hell, he said, wherefore, if thy hand or thy foot offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life halt or maimed rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into everlasting fire. Notice the earnestness and seriousness in which Jesus brings this out. He's basically basically saying, if your hand leads you to sin, if your foot leads you to sin against him, against God, it is better for you to cut your hand off and cut your foot off and go to heaven that way than to go to hell with both hands and both feet. So hell is bad news, isn't it? Hell is a bad place according to Jesus Christ himself. But I have some good news for you. Jesus Christ said in John 3:16, yes, the same Jesus Christ who preached on hell more than any prophet or preacher in the Bible, preached more on hell than he did about heaven. Preached more on hell than most preachers preach on hell today. The meek and lowly and loving Savior was a hellfire and brimstone preacher. But he also said the most loving, most wonderful, most powerful words ever recorded in the history of the world. And he said in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, speaking about Jesus, he was speaking of himself, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So in order for you to be saved from that awful place called hell, eternal death in hell, to be tormented forever, all you have to do is believe in Jesus Christ, according to the words of Jesus Christ. That means you don't have to be in a church to get saved. You don't have to join a church to get saved. You don't have to get baptized to get saved. You don't have to do anything to get saved. The thief on the cross didn't do anything but believe in Christ. And that's all you need to do. So I want to urge you to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ today as your Lord and Savior. And then call on his name and pray and ask him to save you. For the Bible says in Romans 10:9-13, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou you shalt be saved. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So if you're willing to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ today, with all of your heart, follow me in praying the sinner's prayer. Holy Father God, I acknowledge that I am a sinner. For Jesus Christ's sake, please forgive me of all of the sins I've committed against you. I know that I deserve to go to hell, like a criminal deserves to go to jail. For Jesus Christ's sake, please forgive me of all of my sins. As I believe in you, Lord Jesus, I believe with all of my heart, Lord Jesus, that you suffered, you bled, and you died on the cross for my sins. You was buried and rose on the third day. Lord Jesus Christ, please come into my heart and save my soul. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and help me to repent of my sins and to change. And help me to turn away from my evil life and to follow you, Lord Jesus Christ, in the new life. For it is in your name I do pray. Amen. Now, dear friend of mine, if you believed in your heart in the Lord Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ died for your sins, was buried and rose on the third day, allow me to say to you, congratulations on doing the most important thing in life, and that is trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. For more information to help you grow in your newfound faith in Christ Jesus, please go to GospelLightSociety.com and read my book titled, What to Do After You Enter Through the Door. It is a free download. Jesus Christ said in John 10:9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. Dear friend, if you trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today, please email us at dw3@gospellightsociety.com and let us know. We have some free material that we want to send you to help you to grow in the faith. If you have a prayer request, please email that to us as well, and we will pray for you until you tell us to stop. With that, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our Standing Between the Living and the Dead service number one. And we're going to transition into service number two with this song. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, welcome to the Standing Between the Living and the Dead service, number two, a memorial prayer, devotional and evangelistic service, all rolled up into one service. Dr. R. Joyner said, we need a holy addiction to God's presence so that he becomes more important to us than oxygen. Holy Father God, we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray for every person who names the name of Christ, help us to humble ourselves and to pray and to seek your face and to turn from our wicked ways. And Lord, help us all to learn from the chastisement that you put on us. Help us to humble ourselves and to repent. And Holy Father God, I do pray that you help us to repent and get back to you, Lord Jesus Christ, our first love, and back to your family, the names in the name of Christ, and that you would heal these families and help all of these families to pray together, to obey together, and stay together. And fill them with your Holy Spirit to do so. We pray for the millions of families that don't know you as Savior. They're lost, but they blinded eyes and stopped their deaf ears and saved their souls. And Holy Father God, we pray that you would forgive us of our sins and not witnessing to them, not obeying your great commandment or your great commission. And Lord, we pray that you will help us to repent of that and become the true blue witnesses and soul winners you want us to be. In Jesus Christ's name we pray and for our sake. Amen. Recite with me or read with me the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, begotten from the Father, before all ages, God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of the same essence as the Father. To him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, he became incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made human. He was crucified for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered, he died, and was buried. The third day he rose again according to the Scriptures. He was seen alive by Mary Magdalene, disciple of 500 other brethren. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again with glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will never end. And we believe in the Holy Spirit, the giver of life. He proceeds from the Father and the Son, and with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified. He spoke through the prophets. We believe in one holy, universal, and apostolic church. We affirm one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look forward to the resurrection of the dead and to life in the world to come. Amen. Ephesians chapter 6, I believe verse 11 is the verse we're going to read today. We can begin at verse 10. We can begin at verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. And this verse right here, you know, we call Ephesians chapter 5 and 6 the family verses. I do. My family and I have read this passage every day for 33 years almost as a family, to remind everybody in the family of our duties individually and together. And we have always read this passage. And that verse, verse 11, will save your marriage and your family, because you better learn and understand that, yes, the devil can use a family member. Yes, the devil can use a spouse if they allow the devil to do that. And the devil is going to push and agitate in your marriage and in your family. And you've got to hurry up and understand that you don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the devil and his demons. Because if you don't understand that, you're going to hate each other and not hate the devil. And that's why so many marriages have been busted up. There's no other way to explain how marriages that started so missing, so googly-eyed together, end up 5 years later in the divorce court, each other everything other than there's a devil loose. So keep that in mind. Let's pray together. Holy Father God, we pray in the holy name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for your holy word. Help us all as your people to humble ourselves, to pray, to seek your face and to turn from our wicked ways. And Holy Father God, we pray for the salvation and spiritual and family and life, protection and provision blessings, Lord, upon all of the people who are in the ministry of government in this country and around the world, from the president on down. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem, and we pray for all other presidents and governors and prime ministers all around the world. We send blessings upon them, and we pray that we lead God and direct them to go in the way that you want them to go, so that we can live peaceful and quiet lives. And Holy Father God, we pray for the salvation of the lost in this country, along with the world and the media. We pray for the salvation, we pray for the revival of those who are saved in this country, along with the world and the media as well. And Holy Father God, we pray that you heal everybody who is sick, not only the coronavirus, but other sicknesses and illnesses. And the Lord, in this country, Lord, we pray that you would, indeed miraculously heal people as you see fit, based upon your holy word. Ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you. And Holy Father God, we pray for all of the people who are suffering and hurting because of the loss of loved ones from the coronavirus plague, as well as the thousands of others who lost loved ones through other means. We pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that you will comfort them as only you can. You're the root to yourself, Lord Jesus, to comfort them and to save them. And Lord, draw them to your Holy Scriptures to save them and to comfort them as well, as only you can, for we have no words. We pray also for the prisoners and for the persecuted Christians around the world. Lord, comfort them and deliver them and help them to overcome the situation they're in by your grace. And Holy Father God, we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for a few of the people in my name who few of the families, rather, by name, that have lost loved ones to the coronavirus plague. In Jesus Christ's name, we pray, Lord, for the family and friends of British seamstress Hilda Churchill. We pray for the family and friends of New York doctor James T. Goodrich. We pray for the family and friends of New Jersey musician Wallace Running. We pray for the family and friends of Roberto Stella. We pray for the family and friends of Tennessee musician Joe Diffie. We pray for the family and friends of Zimbabwean TV host Zorora Makamba. We pray for the family and friends of New York doctor William Helmrich. We pray for the family and friends of New York musician Alan Merrill. We pray for the family and friends of New York musician Mike Longo. And we pray for the family and friends of New Jersey journalist Alan Finder. We commit all of these souls into your hands, these families, that your will be done in their lives. Lord Jesus, save their souls and comfort their hearts as only you can. And now, Lord, we pray for all of the people who have sent in prayer requests. I will ask one of them, please protect them from the coronavirus. Bless them with salvation, spiritual, family, life, financial, material protection, and provision blessings. And we guide and direct them in the way that you want them to go. We pray, Lord, for Nita. Please comfort and be with Madonna. After her husband's death, we pray for Jason. Please bless him with a job and money to buy food and medicine for his mother. We pray for Vicky. Please heal Cecilia's dog from Lyme disease and leg cysts. We pray for patients. Please bless her with a new job. We pray for Beatrice, Bertha, and Marcus of mental problems. Help TK and Philip not to be confused or angry. Please help Beatrice not to be angry or experience any more setbacks in her life. Help her husband to care for the family and not experience any setbacks either. Lord, we pray for Nisha, for her husband to stop doing what he's doing wrong, and help her to stop doing what she's doing wrong, and for them to work things out and get back together according to your will. Help her to accept your forgiveness. And we pray for Marie, for the blood of Jesus Christ to cover their lives. We pray that for everybody and their property, and keep out all unwanted visitors who will bring harm into their lives. And now, Holy Father God, we pray for all people who have gotten saved through the ministry and all of those who have come back to you for rededication. And we pray for all of the many others who have dedicated their lives as well, and who have gotten saved. And we include them in the prayer. We pray that you'll help them all to grow in the faith and be the Christians you want them to be. We pray for Edward, Arthur, Winnebago, Amor, and Robert, Al, and Joe. We pray also for the people who have rededicated their life to Rod, Patience, Damon, Bob, Suta, Don, and Julie. We commit these souls into your hands, and let your will be done in their lives and in ours. In Jesus Christ's name we pray and for his sake. Amen. Our devotional reading today is The Church in Thy House, Part 1, by none other than the Prince of Preachers, Dr. Charles Spurgeon. Paul writes to Philemon, Philemon, of the church in thy house. Is there a church in this house? Parents, children, friends, servants, all members of it? Or are some still unconverted? let us pause here and let the question go round. Am I a member of the church in this house? How would father's heart leap for joy and mother's eyes filled with holy tears if from the eldest to the youngest all were saved? Let us pray for this great mercy until the Lord shall grant it for us. Ladies and gentlemen, are you a part of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Have you believed in the Lord Jesus Christ? Salvation is not hard. God made it easy for us. So, dear friend, if you're with us today and you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, allow me to show you how you can place your faith and trust in Him for your soul's salvation from the power of sin in your life, the destruction of sin in your life, and the pain and punishment of sin in your life, which is eternal hell. First, accept the fact that you are a sinner and that you have broken God's law. The Bible says in Luke 3, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We all have sinned, I'm sure you would agree with that. Have you ever told a lie? Have you ever stolen anything regardless of the value? Have you ever lusted in your heart, desired in your heart, somebody or something? Have you ever dishonored, disobeyed, disrespected your parents? Have you ever dishonored God? By taking His name in vain. If you've done any of those things, you have broken the Ten Commandments. And I just named five of the Ten Commandments, and the Bible says if you break one point, you break the whole thing. So we all have sinned. We all are guilty of sin. Second, accept the fact that there is a penalty for sin. The Bible says in Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death. The wages of sin is death. That means that we die because of our sin, our sinful nature, and our sinful choices. The body goes to a grave, the soul will go to that awful place called hell, a place of torment, and to be there forever. I have to tell you that because many preachers won't tell you that. If you die without Jesus Christ, the Bible makes it very clear that you will open your eyes in hell, in torments. So thirdly, accept the fact, dear friend, that you're on the road to hell right now. Jesus Christ preached more on hell than anybody in the Bible. And He said in one of His sermons in Matthew 18:8, wherefore if thy hand or thy foot offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life halt or maimed rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into everlasting fire. You see how bad hell is? Hell is so bad that you'll be better off cutting off your hand and your foot to not sin against God and go on to heaven, believe in Christ and go on to heaven, and then to go to hell with both hands and both feet. That's what Jesus did say to you. So this is a very serious matter. Hell is a very serious subject. And hell is bad news, but I have some good news for you. The same Jesus Christ who was a hellfire and brimstone preacher said the most loving, most wonderful, most freeing and liberating words ever said in the history of the world. When he said in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world," that means that if God, that if you're in this world, God loves you. For God so loved the world, if you're in this world, God loves you. No matter how you feel about it, God loves you. You can doubt it all you want to, God still loves you. For God so loved the world, he loved us so much that he gave up his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, as the sacrificial lamb of God for our sins, because Jesus never sinned. Jesus never sinned in the word, thought, or deed, but we have. And so Jesus Christ died for our sins, was buried, and rose on the third day. All you have to do is believe in him, that whosoever, the word whosoever means anybody at any time, red, yellow, black, or white, we're all precious in God's sight. Whosoever believeth, the word believeth means to have faith in, to have, to put trust in. That's it. Nothing hard about it. And notice you're not seeing in the words of Jesus anything about joining a church, anything about getting baptized, anything about speaking in some unknown tongue, or running around the church, or giving money to the church, or giving money to the preacher, or anything like that. Just believe in me, is what he says. That whosoever believeth in him, speaking of himself, Jesus Christ, should not perish. You will not go to hell. The Bible says, Jesus Christ says, rather you will go to heaven, but have everlasting life. That's heaven. So all you have to do is believe in your heart in Jesus Christ. And you're saved. Call on his name. The Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So let's pray a prayer to reflect what's in your heart that you have just done. Let's pray what is called the sinner's prayer, to seal the deal, so to speak. Repeat after me, phrase by phrase, if you don't know how to pray this prayer. Holy Father God, I acknowledge that I am a sinner, and I admit that I indeed have committed one or all of those five sins that were mentioned. I have broken your law, and I deserve to go to hell just like a criminal deserves to go to jail. For Jesus Christ's sake, please forgive me of all of my sins. As I now believe with all of my heart in you, Lord Jesus, who suffered, bled, and died on the cross for my sins, was buried, and rose on the third day. Lord Jesus Christ, please come into my heart and into my spirit and save my soul and change my life. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and help me to repent of all of my sins, and help me to turn from my evil life and to follow you, Lord Jesus Christ, in the new life. Amen. Now, dear friend of mine, if you believed in your heart in the Lord Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, you were buried and rose on the third day, allow me to say to you, congratulations on doing the most important thing in life, and that is trusting Jesus Christ, believing in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. For more information to help you grow in your newfound faith in Christ, please go to GospelLightSociety.com and read my book titled, What to Do After You Enter Through the Door. Jesus Christ said in John 10:9, I am the door. By me of any man, into him, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. Dear friend, if you believe in Jesus Christ as he told you to, as your Lord and Savior, please email us at dw3@gospellightsociety.com and let us know. We have some free material that we want to send you to help you grow in the faith and be a Christian that God wants you to be. If you have a prayer request, please email that to us as well, and we will pray for you until you tell us to stop. Until next time.